Are those apes then carriers of dengue if the female is?
So the question was, if the female lays the eggs, is the virus transmitted to the eggs, right? That's a very good question. So the thought process is that there is plausibility that that could be the case. However, when they've studied this in the wild and in the lab, it just doesn't seem to happen. However, obviously, even when there's dry seasons in parts of the world where you don't have a lot of rain and rain is minimized and mosquito activity goes down, even in these countries that where it's endemic, it still comes back. So that doesn't necessarily mean that it's being transmitted to the eggs, but it might mean that if just a few mosquitoes survive in that short period and still infect another person and then lay eggs, it can live on. But the thinking right now is that it just doesn't work that way. But it could be plausible that that could be happening, but we're not really sure that it's actually
so
happening.
So I understand what you're saying then is, generally speaking, a female that is carrying dengue, that's not transmitted to the larva that she may lay. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
I read in this flyer that Aedes aegypti mosquito was eradicated from the Hawaiian Islands in 49, but rediscovered in 2012. Does that mean that we all of a sudden have Aedes aegypti all over the Hawaiian Islands? And is there any possibility of getting rid of this mosquito species?
Yeah, I used to chase one of those foggers around in my community a long time ago in the 60s. That program was the Aedes aegypti eradication program. Yeah, it was paid by the federal government. It was done on each island. Currently, right now, in the mid-60s, that program had stopped because of lack of federal funding. But the success for removing Aedes aegypti was seen on Kauai, Oahu, Maui, except the Big Island. So we had Aedes aegypti since the 60s on this island, but it's in small pockets, and it's primarily on the drier side of the island. It's on the west side.
Do we also have albopictus?
We have, every island has albopictus. That's the predominant mosquito.
Oh, okay.
But CDC is here today, this week, and the concern is with the aegypti mosquito because it's a more efficient carrier of dengue.
Right, dengue and West Nile and chikungunya and malaria.
No. For malaria, we won't have it in Hawaii because we don't have the Anopheles mosquito. That's the carrier. We don't have Anopheles. It's another type of mosquito. In regards to West Nile, yes, it could be transmitted in Hawaii, but it's not the Aedes mosquito. It's the Culex mosquito, which we have.
What is the recommended treatment for dengue, if any? And is it true that the papaya seed and the papaya leaf cures dengue?
So the clinical guidance, as I said earlier, is actually acetaminophen, Tylenol. It's really just to alleviate the pain. The idea is that your normal immune system response will actually clear the virus of your system. When I was first researching this topic, I actually saw the videos in Thailand and the Philippines that where they're actually demonstrating how to actually make that. I think our district health officer from Maui, Dr. Pang, put it best when he said, if you're going to be ingesting things of, you don't know the total ramifications of doing that, he would recommend not. We know that there's a lot of actually naturally occurring plants that actually can have toxic effects if ingested. So we would recommend not doing that, but we've certainly had people coming forward. There's been interest in it, but certainly that's the best guidance on that we can offer.
Maybe some information. I was in the Tonga Islands many years ago. I was teaching at Atenisi University. There, a small college at Nuku'alofa,
and dengue. We were warned about dengue there, and they gave out some kind of tablets. They said these tablets would either help prevent it or build up your immune system, and I don't know what they were. Would you have any information on this?
I don't think we can recommend. Anecdotally, I also read that communist soldiers in Malaysia were taking certain things that made their blood bitter so the mosquitoes wouldn't bite them. But I mean, that's, you know, there's all kind of things that I'm sure people have tried, but without the kind of scientific rigor that we're looking for, we can't really recommend, and you know, our research hasn't pointed to anything of that nature.
I don't know what it was, but it was done officially through the school, and supposedly it had some scientific backing, but think of this. Tablets name began with a C, carb something, but that's all I remember.
Right. Yeah.
I've seen a lot on Facebook and internet that people are doing these little do-it-yourself type kits to kind of kill the larvae and such. Is there an official endorsement by any of your departments that these kits actually work, and should we start building more? Or, I mean, there's a whole bunch of them too, you know, baking soda and whatever, yeah. But yeah, this one I've seen a lot lately, and I've used it myself, and I'm pretty happy with it.
The way any of these traps are working, right, it's non-selective. So it's going to kill every mosquito or every bug that's attracted inside of it. On that basis alone, I think it's fantastic. You know, whatever, you know, if there's options that people do. I know that Home Depot, I think, I was talking to some individual, and they were bringing in traps there, commercial traps from the mainland that somebody was selling that was eco-friendly. I was just in Puna Palisades prior to coming here talking to another group, and an individual down there, a physicist, is actually making his own and trying to teach his neighbors about it. I think it's great that there's an interest in this. It's not something that we're particularly active in. It's, you know, I wouldn't say there's some selectiveness to it that's not exactly the most efficient either. But if it's killing bugs and killing mosquitoes, you're getting bit less. So, I mean, on that basis alone, I think it's great. And I'd actually like to experiment with the yeast and brown sugar soda one too.
I live in HPP. Any of you want to come to me, I'm willing to share it, because it's like a quart, and it takes just a couple of squirts. And if you want, I posted a picture of the larvae that it has killed so far. It's I'm really impressed. So if anybody wants to see me, I'm here.
It's one of the requests we've made of CDC is to identify what kind of passive traps they have seen really good results with. One of them, as Jason mentioned, the one that Home Depot is bringing in, we saw a study, and it was actually called a lethal OV trap, and it was developed at the request of the Army. So we've asked them to look into some of these studies that were done on passive trapping, because not only for residents, but we're looking at how can we increase the eradication efforts with the mosquito, putting traps around the schools, putting traps around our transfer station, areas where there's breeding grounds, as well as where we are very sensitive to people not wanting chemicals on their property. And if you look at some of the organic farmers having some, you know, reservations about spraying chemicals that may affect their organic status. So we're looking at every different type of solution that can probably meet anyone's needs, because people may have different interests on what products they're going to use.
I have some friends that are using bleach and some of their standing water, you know, buckets that they use to hold down their, you know, is that going to work? And also, what are you spraying from the air?
So the bleach, actually, people have been actually using bleach in catchment tanks as well. So I know that's, you know, especially in this area and large portions of lower Big Island, that's an issue. Bleach does do it. If there's standing water, you can use bleach. You can also use a solution of dish detergent, about 4 to 6 ounces of dish detergent per gallon of water. But essentially that just like the kind of spraying oil on the surfaces of water too, doesn't allow the larva to escape. But it's prone to, if it rains, you know, that then the integrity of that layer could be compromised, and then you lose that protection. Same thing goes with using bleach in pockets of water. If that doesn't dry up and it rains, that concentration is going to dilute, and at some point it could go back to being advantageous for mosquitoes to lay eggs. So you know, in many of these ways, either the soapy solution or the bleach, it's a maintenance issue. If that, you know, hopefully we're heading into a drier winter, and that's going to kind of make sure that some of those pockets start to dry up and you don't have longer pools of water. But if you treat it and then it rains, you kind of lose some of that protection.
What we're spraying is called aqua resin. It's a Perithium product. It's a restricted purchase product where only programs like the Department of Health nationwide can pick up. The product was reviewed by our physician in the EMS unit in Honolulu. His name is Al Bronstein. His former position was medical director for the Poison Control Center in Colorado. He reviewed the product, and the product, he basically said it's a excellent product of choice and it's very safe. Just for your information, we're currently looking at another product to use. We're fearful of a resistance buildup in the mosquitoes, so we're probably looking at a integrated pest management program, maybe alternating to another and rotating another adulticide in. We haven't made that decision on what that would be yet.
I'm seeing a chemical approach to this situation, and I'm not seeing all of the potential strategies being used. It's not difficult for me to go online and look at the World Health Organization's case study approach to how they treat malaria and how they respond, not malaria, but dengue in this case, and how they respond with vector control and community outreach and the plans that they have that are established as part of that general protocol of public relations. And that's something that I would like to see transparent, posted. I heard some talk about mosquito nets, and here we are waiting for Hope Services. I've called them up. They don't pick up their phone after 4 o'clock, after 4:30 on a weekday. They're not picking up their phone. It's a message system loop. Put the extension in. So there's some talk about United Way. So here we are scrounging mosquito nets, and we're 2 months into an epidemic. We've reached a benchmark. And I could go on the internet and say that wholesale mosquito nets go for between $1 and $5 each. And you can buy 1,000 of them for $5,000. That's about about 7% of the $70,000 that have gone into this budget for Fight the Bite. Why don't we have mosquito nets here? I can also say that DEET is poison. I could go online on Wikipedia. It's not supposed to be used with women that are pregnant. They're the high-risk population. I know I have friends who are pregnant who are living in Noni Farms Road area on undeveloped land, building structures, living in alternative communities who are not here. I don't see any of the people who I think are at highest risk. And these are the people who shop and spend a lot of money making Russell Ruderman his income at the natural food store because they don't want pesticides, they don't want GMOs. This is scary. I mean, this has serious consequence to this island. 220,000 people come here to visit. That's a lot of income and tourism. Could that change if dengue took hold? What would that bring the economy? This is not the first time there's been a dengue outbreak or dengue scare. It would seem that there'd be already plans in effect beyond this stage. There'd be mosquito nets in a Matson crate. There's a lot of information out there already on how it's been effectively dealt with. And mosquito nets are just barrier protection. It's just correct. Like handing out condoms when there's an HIV epidemic. Sure. There has to be ways to get to a population that are culturally sensitive. And we're in Pahoa, and I'm telling you right now, I know people who have these symptoms who are not coming forward. I have a friend who is moved to Hilo because 5 of her neighbors have these symptoms, and they're not coming forward. And they're all sleeping in subpar conditions, and there's no mosquito nets.
Okay, so the question regarding the mosquito nets, if we could, so we can get on to other questions.
Well, I think his first comment or question dealt with if this is just primarily a chemical response to the outbreak. And what we'd like to share is that the reason we requested the CDC to come down was to evaluate not only the outbreak itself, but what strategies are being used to respond to the outbreak. And what we expect to get out from Dr. Peterson's visit is, do we need to change tactics or strategies or add to the tactics and strategies on how we're going to deal with this based on CDC's experience and what they've seen in other outbreaks across the world? So we're very optimistic if he's going to come up with, or his team will come up with, some other solutions. We've already had some discussion. As one example, should we be putting more attention to larvicides or addressing the larvae versus the adult mosquito as a way of getting stronger hold on this particular outbreak? His entomologists are in the field as we speak, researching both what types of species we're seeing and the concentrations where they're at, and which is maybe the predominant vector that's spreading this particular outbreak. So we're waiting for his results, and we're looking forward to suggestions and corrections or revisions or changes to that. As far as the chemical properties for the DEET, I would turn it over to Aaron and Jason to comment on your concerns for the toxicity. As far as the mosquito nets, definitely we can do more and try to do things more and faster, but definitely have identified that as a one barrier, not necessarily the only barrier, to help protect these people. And if you know of individuals who are ill, I would definitely welcome the opportunity to talk to you. If we can get the information on how we can reach out to them, as I mentioned, we have the multidisciplinary teams that would go out and reach out to them rather than ask them to come in because maybe they don't feel comfortable coming in. And through maybe a contact like yourself, if they feel comfortable with you introducing the team to them, that's a means of getting the services to them. We don't have all the answers. You folks are bringing forward some very good ideas, but I can tell you this has been an aggressive approach to this particular outbreak through everybody working together, and that includes you folks.
About a week ago, I was doing my neighbor's yard and had this certain plant inside her yard that only cup the water, but then it stopped. But for the past about, well, let's say about 3 to 4 days, I've been noticing like I'm getting, you know, like I thought it was, you know, rash or something, but you know, something, but it's not irritating, or it's not turning red unless I play with it like that and stuff. You know, but then good thing I came tonight because one of the symptoms is rash. So I called my doctor today, make an appointment, come in next week, Thursday. But if this is, all he's gonna do is just send me to the blood place, right, take blood tests. I'm willing to go right now to the hospital, emergency like that and stuff, to get this, you know.
You may be experiencing a rash, I'm not a clinician, of course, but if you don't have those other symptoms, you may have been in contact with something, I'm not sure. If your condition worsens, if you start feeling any of those other symptoms, yeah. I'd say, if it's close to the doctor's office, go. If not, urgent care can probably take you in. But if it's just a rash, there's so many things that could be.
It's starting to go more and more, wider spreading.
Right. There's a lot of things that could be causing that. It's not, most anecdotally, I think sometimes that rash sometimes appears on the tail end after the fever breaks. But if you're not having any of those other symptoms, it could possibly just be some kind of, contact with something that's irritating your skin. If it worsens, if you see other symptoms, I'd say definitely, urgent care. If it's really bad and you have a really turn of events, 911 if it's a medical emergency. But it sounds as if it's kind of just some kind of contact reaction that you're having, but
that's the first time that I actually went go work on my neighbor's yard, cut down somebody's yard and stuff.
Yep.
My wife and I debated about coming here tonight, but good thing that she insisted to come because I learned a lot of information.
Right, but as I said, we'd expect you'd have a fever concurrent with that symptom because that's the number one thing usually people have: fever plus those other symptoms. So doesn't quite sound like it, but continue to monitor it. And if things turn adverse, try to get into your doctor. Sometimes doctors have urgent same day appointments. Tell them it's, I really am concerned about this. If not, if it's after hours, urgent care. And there's options. You're going to probably have to make that call. It may just be, you may have a severe skin reaction to something that's just making you feel very uncomfortable, and treating that would be helpful no matter what it is. So, ultimately that's your call to make.
If I could just share one more thing, because I know it relates to this gentleman's concerns, and that is, We met with the healthcare facilities around the island. That includes Puna Community Medical Center, Bay Clinic, the hospitals, et cetera, all the facilities around the island. Every one of them has said that they will accept people coming in. If you can't get an appointment with your doctor, don't have a doctor, don't have health insurance, no one will be turned away for inability to pay. They will definitely welcome people in because of this outbreak and try to help with the process. And this evening earlier, we were introduced to the Vitality Natural Medical Clinic here in Pahoa. They too said that they have had people come in, people who are maybe reluctant to go into the traditional facilities but feel comfortable going to them. They have made referrals for lab work. And of the cases that they made referrals, they were grateful because it came back negative from the lab. So I would say I can share this information with you for your friends as well, that they're open and willing to see people if, again, they're not looking to go into a traditional medical facility.
The thing I was kind of thinking about is when you go to the stores now and you go to the shelves, you're trying to look for mosquito repellents, you know, the punk, the mosquito punk. And it's like wipe out, which really, really, if you light the punk and you put it right in the area where the mosquitoes are, they actually will kill the mosquitoes. And the whole deal is, I was wondering if you guys can help to rush it, rush the mosquito punk thing.
Twice a week we call every one of the retailers, which includes the Malama markets, the Longs, everybody. We're asking them the status of their shelves, as well as we've been talking to the distributor, talking to the manufacturer, and asking everybody to rush all the materials, as well as we're working on trying to get a shipment in donated from the manufacturers that can be made available for those that can afford, as well as close the gap. And again, the mayor has been very gracious and generous to buy materials. We have some here, so if you need off repellent, we have here for you folks to take tonight. We'd ask, you know, one per household, so we brought, you know, several cases. Please. And again, we're trying to make sure that products are available, because it does you no good if we're telling you use repellent, use clothing, all the, and you can't even get the materials. So we'll keep working on that.
Yeah, it really works.
Thank you.
So our presenters are going to be around for a little while more. If you have questions, you can come up and ask. My staff, Nadia and Chan, just informed me if you do want more repellent, there's some available, more available, so not just one per household. I guess we'll get it out